So the usual bunch is back. It's always nice to resume with familiar faces. Hi. So today we'll speak about one of the simplest techniques that I find when it comes to NLP, which is collapsing anchors. It doesn't need any language. It doesn't need any complex processes. It's something that we can really very easily use for various kinds of applications. So this is part 8 of the series. We've dealt with basics in terms of pacing, representational systems. Swish pattern is one of the early patterns we dealt with. Then we spoke about meta model and Milton model, which are more to do with the spoken language part of NLP. Metaphors as well, which is a part of the spoken language. The last time we spoke about reframing, which is about shifting beliefs using a certain NLP process. So today we're going to be speaking about collapsing anchors. So before we begin, let's talk about anchor in itself. Anchor, as the term suggests, is something that is held, something that's anchored, and something that means a particular thing, or it evokes a particular reaction in all of us. So in NLP term, it's an anchor is a connection between a stimulus and a response, and in this case we mean an emotional response. All of us have various kinds of anchors. So sometimes we remember an old song and a particular memory triggers off, right? Some old Bollywood song, which may have nothing to do with the memory directly. It's just that that particular incident or memory happens to be anchored to that auditory memory of the particular song. Sometimes we pass by a particular lane or a street and we smell something. Maybe we smell our favorite dish in a restaurant. Often happens to me when I pass by Matunga and there's that smell of sambar and idli. And it evokes certain memories. For me, it evokes memories of college time when you would pass around that area. And there is a lot of emotional response that comes along with just the smell and the memory of that, the memory that the smell evokes. So anchors are of various types. There are visual anchors. Visual anchors are possibly the most common anchors, and they are used very powerfully and evocatively by advertisers, right? The very notion of a logo and a brand image and advertising, visual advertising, is really about using a visual anchor to trigger a certain, hopefully happy memory or a happy emotion, and thereby making the consumer want more of that particular product or service. Auditory memory is created by the memory of words, sounds, music, rhythm, tone sometimes. Kinesthetic memory is the memory of touch, of feeling, right? A particular kind of a touch or a particular kind of a feeling can evoke a certain kind of a memory, good or bad. Olfactory, which is the memory of smell, right? It's the monsoon seasons, and for a lot of us, the smell of wet mud has a lot of olfactory memory. It could take us back to our childhood. It could take us back to perhaps our native places where the arrival of rains meant that it would be lush green everywhere. And there is, of course, gustatory memory, which is the memory of taste. And certain tastes can also anchor certain emotions. So if you've had a particular dish, let's say, which your mom made long ago.
Birthday party.
Yes. Yeah, it can bring back nice memories of, let's say, birthday parties when we were children, or a wedding, or a vacation perhaps. So we live with various kinds of anchors within us. Can we anchor something deliberately? Yes, we can. Right? So, and which is where the usage of anchors in NLP comes in, where it's possible to anchor something in a very physical manner and in a very deliberate manner so as to evoke a particular kind of a response. Now, one thing to remember here is anchors are more often than not in the short term memory. So it's not something that you would anchor for life, unless you repeatedly keep using the same anchor over and over again, and thus it stays for life. Otherwise, by nature, anchors are usually in the short-term memory, unless the emotional impact happens to be huge for some reason. Now, how do we anchor? We often anchor a lot of people around us in an unconscious way. For example, when a child does something well and you go pat him on the back, that's an anchor. The pat on the back is an anchor. So the next time a child doesn't happen to do something specifically well, but you still go, or you or anybody else goes and pats him on the back, he feels good because pat on the back is anchored to nice memory. It is anchored to praise. It's anchored to appreciation. And therefore, it, even if the child happens to be in not so good an emotional state at that point, he'll start feeling better because a positive anchor was triggered and applied. So it's possible for us to use anchors positively, and a lot of us do so in terms of, especially if you're feeling low and you go and listen to particular kind of a song or a music and we start feeling better, it's because we've anchored a good memory or a nice feeling to that particular song. Now, today the process of collapsing anchors that we're talking about is a process of deliberate creation of anchors. What we've been speaking about so far is unconscious anchors which get created whether we do it deliberately or not. Now, when we talk of collapsing anchors, we're doing two things. One, we are anchoring a negative emotion, and then we are anchoring a positive emotion, and then merging the two. But of course, merging the two in a process in a way that the negative emotion is overcome by the positive, and therefore the person starts feeling better. Now, collapsing anchors can be used in various kinds of situations. It could be used to overcome a certain kind of fear. So, let's say if I have a fear of public speaking and I want to replace the fear with confidence, I could use collapse anchor to make sure that the fear gets replaced with confidence, the anchor of confidence. It could be used if I tend to feel sad or depressed about a particular person or a situation. It could be used to change that state of mind. So any unresourceful state can be replaced with a resourceful state. So how do we anchor? It's a really simple process. The first thing that we do is, and with collapse anchor, it really helps to have somebody partnering with you in the process. You can also do this process by yourself, but specifically with this particular technique of NLP, I find it really helpful if somebody is doing it with me, or if I am doing it with a client instead of the client doing it for himself or herself. So first step you would do is elicit the unresourceful state, which would mean, so if I'm speaking to a particular client, I would ask about what is it that you would like to overcome. So let's say this particular person says that I'm scared of making presentations, and I have a fear of public speaking, and every time I think of going up to a stage, I think of audience in front of me, I feel tense, I feel nervous. Now the things that we need to note are all the visible reactions that you can see. So this person might give you a physical reaction of nervousness, muscles clenching, perhaps the shoulders drooping, the eye movements going up and down in a certain way, the voice tremoring perhaps. Okay. And when the person, and try and make the person speak about this as much as possible, speak in detail about what happens to this person when he or she is called up to make a presentation. And at that point in time, during the conversation, start anchoring that state. How do we anchor? We anchor using any kind of a physical touch. Touch is the easiest way to anchor. You can also use auditory or visual modalities, but touch is the easiest anchor if you're present with the person. So you could possibly, let's say, press a particular finger as the person is talking. So you can hold the finger while the person is talking about this unresourceful state and keep pressing the finger lightly. And this particular touch becomes a gustatory anchor for the person, a kinesthetic anchor for the person, and it's a negative anchor. Right? And do this enough, do this for at least a couple of minutes as the person keeps talking about that unresourceful state, in this case the fear of
his
public speaking.
Has to do,
yes, body. Yes. So if I'm working with you, as you speak about what you want to overcome, I would keep anchoring. Right? And it's important that I keep, I remember what have I anchored where, because you're anchoring two different states here. You can do this for yourself also, but it really helps if somebody is doing it for you.
For self, it is very difficult to identify those parameters. Because suppose I am coming here and speaking.
Yes.
So, I may have some like short talk or some trembling or something.
Yes.
So, but in that case, if I am visualizing, I cannot visualize that really what is happening. Somebody else will really know.
Yes, which is where it helps to have a partner in the process. However, you can do this even in the, let's say you're in the process of preparing for a talk. You can still do this process for yourself. So you just sit at one place and you think about what happens to you when you're about to go up and speak. And elicit that unresourceful state, which means let yourself completely associate with that state. Imagine going up there on the stage, there's audience in front of you. Yeah, so imagine that entire unresourceful state, let yourself feel the fear, the trepidation, and you can anchor yourself, which means you just tap at a particular place, you know, and keep tapping till the time you're imagining that particular process. So you could do it with a finger, shoulders, whatever way you think works for you. Or if you want, you can play a particular kind of music as you think about this state, if you think auditory anchors work better. But touch is the easiest anchor to work with and to collapse later. Right? So, elicit that unresourceful state, make sure it stays for a couple of minutes at least while you anchor it really firmly. And then break that state. Right? Break the state simply means just get up for a minute, shake it off. Walk around, talk about something totally different. Doesn't matter what you talk about. Talk about the weather, talk about sports, anything that completely shifts a person's mind, emotions, and the physiology. It's important to completely break the state. And the reason we break the state is to later test will the anchor work? You've anchored a negative state. Will the anchor work? Right? So you break out of the state for a minute or so and then fire that negative anchor that you have earlier established. Okay. Now, how do we test the anchor? So, you as a partner would simply fire the anchor, which means you would simply press the same place that you've anchored it to earlier and check, does the person's physiology change? Okay. If you've anchored it well, it'll mean that even after breaking state, if you trigger my anchor, I would start feeling nervous. My body language shift to that droopy nervous state. My voice would shift as I speak with you. And I would go into a state of fear. Because somewhere, this for me is a memory of fear. It's a memory of trepidation. Right? So test that anchor. Does the anchor really work? If you've done it well, it should work the first time around. So leave it at that. If you think the anchor is not triggering that intensity of feeling which the person is trying to overcome, then anchor it a little more. Let the person speak a little more about that fear, that nervousness, that unresourceful state. Anchor it a little more, break state, test it again, till the time you're sure that the negative anchor is well established. Break state again. Just let the person get up, move around, speak about something different, change the emotional quality of the moment, and then elicit a resourceful state. Now, if there is a specific kind of replacement or resourceful state that you would like for the person, so for example, if I'm working on public speaking, instead of fear, I might want confidence, right? So in that case, lead the person into a conversation about when is it that you're likely to feel, when is it that you do feel very confident about? And it could be a totally different state. It may have nothing to do with public speaking. Right? I might tell you that I feel very confident when I'm cooking in the kitchen because I know exactly how to get a dish right. right? So let me talk a little more about it. Let me give you details about what that confidence means to me. It could mean joy, it could mean a shift of body language, my tone will change when I speak about cooking, right? So, and as I speak more and more about this resourceful state, anchor the state as well, right? So I've got a negative anchor, anchor the positive state, right? Which means you keep pressing another part of the body as you anchor this particular state. In this case, I'm talking about a kinesthetic anchor. You want a visual or an auditory anchor, you can use that as well. But this is easiest to collapse later. So anchor this for ideally a longer time than the negative anchor, because this is the resource that we ultimately want to use. So anchor the resourceful state really well. Keep what is called stacking the anchor, which means you pile up a lot of this positive anchor, a lot more than the negative one. Then again, break that state, which means change the topic, get up, walk around, and fire that positive anchor, right? Fire the resourceful anchor and check if the person's body language instantly changes to feeling confident, feeling good, and the tone changes to something that is positive. If it does, you know that the positive anchor is working as well. If it doesn't, or if it doesn't lead to any major reaction when you test the anchor, stack it a little more. Let the person speak a little more about this confidence generating resourceful state. So I could speak a lot more about cooking and my success stories and how people have liked my dishes and all of that, and keep stacking this positive anchor till the time you break the state and test and you're sure that the positive anchor works nicely as well, right? Which means ideally, the good test for an anchor is where the body language shifts immediately. That's the most visible thing to notice. The tone of voice often changes a lot. Eye movements very often are a good clue. If I'm in an unresourceful state somewhere, I'm going to be scattered all over the place. I might look down. I might not want to have eye contact. Whereas when I'm in a nice resourceful state, I'm usually looking forward, looking up and speaking confidently. So these are steps to establish anchors. You establish the negative and the positive, the unresourceful and the resourceful anchor. Now, it's important again to break the state, which means not necessarily a few minutes, but a few moments at least, walk around, speak about something else. And while the person is in that neutral state, collapse the anchors, which collapsing anchors would mean fire both the anchors simultaneously, right? What we're trying to do is, because you're merging the two anchors, the idea is that the brain replaces the memory of this with the memory of this.
But while doing simultaneously, again we have to visualize something? No.
We're just firing the anchor physiologically. Yeah. So just fire both the anchors. Hold on long enough, and what happens in this process is initially when you fire, having established both the anchors well, initially when you fire, the brain first gets a little confused. So the person might just go blank for a while because the brain doesn't know whether to be happy or sad or feel good or bad because both the things are fired simultaneously. Right? So initially for a moment, the person might just be blank. It's okay. Just keep firing the anchors, keep holding, keep pressing the anchor. And after a while, let go of the unresourceful anchor, let go of the negative space, hold on to the positive space. Right? Somewhere the brain gets a message that, okay, it's the positive state which I want to retain, not the negative one. So even if this fires, what will stay is this, right? The negative fires, but the positive will stay. So this collapsing process needs to be done several times, which means you hold on for, let's say, 15-20 seconds, let go of the negative, let the positive stay for a few seconds longer, then again fire both, which means collapse it again. Keep doing this for a few minutes till you think that the person is left in a positive state, right? So if you think the overall the body language doesn't seem to go down no matter which one you fire, you make sure that you hold on to the anchor. So keep collapsing. Collapsing would mean fire both the anchors together. let go of the negative a little before you let go of the positive, and then keep repeating the process for a while. At the end of the process, where you think that the anchors have shifted, responses shifted, again break the state, and then once the person is in a neutral zone, test. Now in this case, the test is fire the negative anchor, fire the unresourceful anchor, and see what happens. Does the person respond in the positive manner? So you fire the anchor for public speaking. Is my body language shifting to what it was when I was talking of cooking? That's what you wanted to test, right? Because you've replaced this memory with this, and if you've done that successfully, even if you trigger this memory, my response will be the other thing, the positive state. If that does happen, it means that you fired the memory of public speaking, and all I can think of is the confidence that I experience when I'm cooking, then the collapse is successful, which means the next time I'm in a position of public speaking, I will not be thinking about my fear and anxiety, but I'll be thinking about how confident I am when I'm cooking, and given that I could be confident there, I could also be confident in this situation. So you're bringing in a resource from one state into another state. You're making that resource of confidence available in a state where it is really required. Sometimes you might find that there is a little residue of the negative anchor. So when you fire that negative anchor, I might feel a little confident, but somewhere at the thought layer, I might feel, okay, I don't know, I'm not so sure, I'll think about it. If that's the case, then stack up a little more of the positive anchor. So you go back into the process, let the person talk a little more of the positive resource, stack it a little more, collapse again, fire both the anchors again, till the point comes where no matter how much you fire the negative anchor, the reaction is just positive. It's only resourceful. That's the process where the anchors have totally collapsed, which means that no matter how much that negative state gets triggered, my response is always resourceful. It's always positive. Right? Of course, that's technically the end of the collapsing anchor process, but you can go a little further and try and get the person to associate one with the past. So you can make the person think about, okay, the last time that you had to give a speech, talk about what happened. Am I able, and it may have been a disastrous situation for me, I may have forgotten my speech, I may have fumbled, but am I able to talk about it without getting into that droopy, nervous, gloomy state? Am I able to talk about it just as a memory, which means I've detached all my emotions from that space? So the next time around I have an opportunity to speak, I don't go with those emotions, I go with a neutral or a positive feeling. So that's one way of testing. You can check for the past and also do what is called future pacing, which means make me imagine that the next week you've got an opportunity to present something to people. How are you going to approach it? How do you feel about it? And let me live that in my head.
Let at that time you have to do positive?
Ideally, just let the person imagine it. If you think the person is wavering, not so sure, then keep firing the positive anchor even at that point.
And in actual, doing fully.
Yes.
If in actual situation,
if
some amount of that particular fear or something is coming.
Yes.
At that time, if we press that positive, will.
Now, here's the important thing there. If you do want to do that, make sure that you are stacking up on the positive anchor consistently. So, for example, you've collapsed anchors for me today and my speech is next week, right? The anchor is in my short-term memory. So, if I do want to use it the next week, it's important that I keep stacking up on it all through the week. Right? So for me, it's important that maybe I spend even 5 minutes a day. It doesn't take too long, but even 5 minutes a day, if I spend stacking up on the positive anchor, which means I keep thinking about all my confidence areas, success areas, keep stacking it up. And then just before I'm about to give the speech next week, I fire the positive anchor. Then yes, the resourceful state will come up for me.
Just
negative anchor you press,
mm-hmm.
Anchor, mm-hmm. And you talk about the negative, this, the person
unresourceful state.
State.
Yes.
So, how that is going to work?
So that's the first step in the process, right? So you start off with establishing the negative anchor, because you need, you want to shift that anchor, right? You want to shift that association. So for you to be able to collapse the negative into the positive state, you need to establish the negative anchor. But having said that, that is not something you stack up, right? So you don't do too much of that, you just establish it.
Mm-hmm. Testing,
mm-hmm.
instead of this opposite you've done,
mm-hmm.
like while pricing the negative,
mm-hmm.
and talking about the cooking,
mm-hmm.
and seeing the response of the person, and similarly while happy state and talking about public speaking, so mm-hmm. how that will
be. See, the thing with if I'm speaking about cooking and I'm in a very nice confident state, if you happen to press, let's say, this particular finger, then that's the state that's anchor, which means for me this finger is a positive anchor.
If the topic is different, if the topic mm-hmm. is different,
in
the
sense?
If the topic is cooking,
hmm.
then that related point you don't to press, it will work. But in the case, if the point, if the speech is different,
mm-hmm.
the cooking is related to that.
Feeling you are changing, right?
Mm-hmm. Feeling. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you're establishing a negative anchor.
Collapsing the anchor, you hmm. are saying earlier, hmm. while, because here we have associated this finger hmm. with the what?
Negative. Yeah. So let's say left hand is negative, right hand is positive, for example.
You talk about unresourceful state.
Hmm.
So chances are the person will go more into that state. While if we talk about positive state,
mm-hmm.
and we press the anchor to see how well anchored.
No, but for the person to be able to access the positivity or the resourcefulness of the state, there needs to be a negative anchor that needs to get replaced, right? So therefore, it's necessary to establish the unresourceful anchor also. It's just that we're not stacking up on it. See, the brain needs a reference point for both at this time. The brain needs a reference point for the negative anchor and it needs a reference point for the positive anchor. What we are trying to do is make sure that the negative anchor gets overcome by the positive. But for it to do that, you need both the anchors. You can't bypass the negative anchor, if that's what you mean.
We should face that negative.
Yeah. See, ultimately, it's a physiological replacement of the memory that you're trying to do. So, you need both the anchor. So, and see, end of the day, I'm using the term negative very loosely. All we are saying is it's an unresourceful state. There is nothing inherently negative about it. It's just that it's not a very productive state. So, all you're doing is replacing that lack of productivity with something which is productive and useful for you. So, the state in itself is not negative, it's just not resourceful. Right? So, the whole idea of collapsing is to make sure that the stimulus gets replaced with a different response. Right? So, the stimulus in this case is public speaking, the response used to be negative, it used to be fear. Now, the response is positive, it is confidence, it is looking forward.
Anchored with positive.
Yeah, so you've changed the anchor for the stimulus. The stimulus remains where it is. The anchor just gets changed. Response gets changed. So, it helps to, while you can end at collapsing the anchor, it really helps if you're doing some bit of future pacing and past pacing to check if the person is genuinely has replaced the anchors. Like all processes in NLP, collapsing anchors is also a one-time process, which means for one particular issue, even if you do it well one time, good enough. It's just that if you happen to want to use that same anchor much later, which could mean next week, next month, then it helps to continue the positive anchor.
Till it is embedded.
Yeah, till it's absolutely, you know, in my system. And of course, sometimes you might want to anchor something for life. So you might, you know, like for example, you know, a lot of us anchor the visual of a candle or a diya with a state of calm meditation. So you light the diya and you sit there, you feel calm, right? Which is something that we anchor for a long term. So whether you've done it when you're 6 years old or 60 years old, you still feel the same sense of calmness when you see a flame. So there could be things which are anchored for life, but that's if you come across the anchor over and over again, you trigger the anchor again and again. Otherwise, the collapse anchor steps in itself can work for a limited period of time. Which means, so let's say today if I have anchored fear here and confidence here, it doesn't mean that I cannot use these fingers for something else later. I can use this for entirely different emotions later in a couple of days. Right? Because it's very much in the short term memory, unless you specifically use it for the long term. So that's collapse anchor. I find it one of the most easy to use techniques.
It is almost similar, not similar exactly. Swish technique.
Swish.
So you enlarge it.
Yes.
And,
yeah.
Put into negative.
Yeah, there you switch the submodalities. This I find this a much simpler process, because with swish you're deliberately shifting submodalities.
Totally mind here, you are connecting body.
Yeah. So this can be done even with swish. You need a lot of engagement of the other person. This, even if the other person is absolutely disengaged, you can still do it because it's a pure physiological process.
It's simplified.
Yeah. So you don't have to make the person imagine anything, you don't have to make the person think, concentrate, nothing of that sort. You're just sitting across, having a conversation, and you can keep firing positive anchors. So especially with children, works really beautifully because they don't have to do anything in the process. You could be talking about a fairy tale in the process, it doesn't really matter. But you can keep firing and collapsing anchors as you go along. Okay. So, and in fact, you can use a single metaphor. For example, you can fire, let's say when you're talking about the story of, let's say a demon who's and a princess who's rescued or something of that sort, you could fire a negative or the unresourceful anchor of a demon where you're talking of firing fear, and then you're firing happiness and peace and joy at the end of it, and then you can collapse it at the end of the story so that the negative is replaced by the positive, or the child can overcome fear through the process of a simple story without knowing that there has been a process. Yeah. So it's a very easy technique to use. It doesn't really involve the other person's involvement in a mental sense of the term. So long as the person's willing to work with it physically, that's good enough. So that's collapse anchors. Thank you.